Greetings and welcome to the podcast. I'm Pete Lorimer, former hit record producer and now owner of LA's most creative boutique real estate firm, PLG Estates. On the podcast, you'll always find business and real estate strategy, marketing techniques, and tips for the entrepreneur, so hit that subscribe button. On the show this week, I have a special celebrity realtor guest, Mr. Gary Gold, who just sold the Playboy Mansion for $105 million. He's going to be going over his secrets to success, how he prospects, lead follow-up, and everything else, so thanks for joining us. The interview you're about to hear was recorded via Skype live in Beverly Hills.
So, ladies and gentlemen, I want to introduce you to the world famous realtor to the gods, Mr. Gary Gold, that has been one of the premier real estate agents in Los Angeles. And we're going to get into who he's sold to. Well, maybe not who he's sold to, but what kind of properties he sold, because we have to be discreet in our game. But he's a mate. And I want to thank you for coming on the podcast. It's delightful to have you, Gary.
Awesome. How you doing?
So this is really more two mates kind of chatting. I guess if somebody's watching this from Kansas or from Leeds, my hometown in Northern England, how do you go from, and I know real estate wasn't your first career. It generally isn't for most of us.
In my case, it was.
Oh, it was?
Yes. Well, hold on. I was a box boy at a supermarket before this.
I thought you did some comedy as well, though.
I did stand up, but I was already in real estate.
Oh.
And it's certainly, I never made money on it. It's actually hard to break into stand-up comedy.
Yeah.
When you're already making six figures in real estate.
I know.
Yeah. It's way better if you don't mind crashing on your friend's thing and eating ramen. And I mean, when you're making six figures, it's hard to suffer.
I know, it's like real estate, and don't get me wrong, this is I think we filed this away under quality problem, but
right.
It's kind of a dream crusher. I mean, you start earning, and we're both, Gary and I are very grateful, but you start earning great money and you're like, but I want to sail in the Atlantic and catch cod, and you're like, well, I'm never gonna make any money doing that. Where are you from, Gary?
I am from the Valley. I'm from Encino.
That's funny. So not only are you one of the few that's from this town, you started in real estate. So you're a twofer.
So when I was 17 years old, I tried to paint my car. And just note to anyone out there listening, if you're Jewish, don't try to paint your own car. It's just not in our DNA.
Okay.
We're good to get people to paint the car. So I destroyed my car when I was 17 and I needed a car. And my brother, who was 21, who was successful in real estate, said, come work for me, I'll buy you a car. I had no interest in being in real estate. I wanted to be like a songwriter or a comedian or something like that. I'm a creative person. I had no sales game at all. But I went to work for him and I started doing all this marketing. And I was able to be very, very creative. And he just said, do whatever you want. And he was 21, good-looking guy, and everyone else in the 70s in the Valley who sold real estate were basically legally dead. There were these old housewives, and there was very few people that were like today. It wasn't a hip business for them, especially in the Valley. So my brother was very quirky, and he liked what he liked, and he wore shorts 24/7, 12 months a year. He wore tennis shorts. He was a good looking guy. And he drove around the Valley in his Corvette. And we took on this persona of being so much different than everyone else. And we really played on that and did some really out of the box marketing that might seem commonplace today, but literally we invented it at the time. The idea of kind of like the rock star real estate agent. I wasn't saying I'm inventing something, but we just did this thing and I was super creative and he just told me I could do whatever I want and I did.
Well, I mean, it's testament to your career because, I mean, I think it's fairly safe to say this and I'm not going to, I mean, I love the industry that I'm in. I know you love it, but there are a lot of personalities, but what I love about you, and every time I see you and when I see your videos, which I'm going to touch upon later, and when I run into you out there, you know, in when I saw you last time, you just have this kind of raw, like no bullshit, just, you know your way around any situation, big or small, hundreds of millions or a couple of million. And you just have this non-snooty, just, I don't know, just this confidence and rawness that I like about you. And I'm sure it's been commented on by your clients.
Yeah, you know, I've been doing this for a long, long, long time. I've been doing it almost 40 years. I don't know any else. I'm super smart. It's a little obvious, but I'm not like, I went to like Cal State Northridge. I couldn't find a parking spot and I left and I went to so, no, you're right. I don't know what it is. I just always did it and I did it with fun and I've been doing it a long time. And when I started in real estate, this is when Jimmy Carter was around, and interest rates were like 20%+. So to do a deal was so complicated, and I learned how to do it in a very complex way. And I learned from my brother, who was a really great salesman. So, and you know what? I've had my ass kicked so many times that probably adds to some humility. I mean, I've definitely had ups and downs. So it's not like I started here and it's been a rocket to Mars.
So everyone that's watching, I'm sure, is familiar with your credentials, but we've found the genesis of where you started. So then the Playboy mansion, which you sold successfully a couple of years ago.
Right.
How, first of all, what was the price point on that? What did you sell it for?
Sold it for $105 million.
$105 million.
Yeah. The first house to ever sell in LA over $100. And as an interesting aside, when it sold originally to Hugh Hefner in 1971, it sold for $1 million, and it was the first house to ever sell over $1 million.
75. It was $1 million bucks, and then it went up 100%. Yeah. No, more than 100%. Like,
it was the first house to ever sell for over $1 million.
God, wow.
A little inflation.
Just a touch. So how is there any difference between selling a... Now, there are people here who are selling houses that are probably 150,000 in the Midwest. Is there any difference for you? I mean, of course there are differences, but is the theory grossly different from 100 million to 5 million? Or is it, walk us through that, because I'm sure some agents are like, how the hell do you sell a house that's $100 million?
In this particular case, it was. This was the most complicated case, I mean, sale I've ever made by 100. But fortunately, as I said, my first deal was an equity trade land contract, which I haven't done since. And it was so complicated. And my second deal had a second trust deed with 28 individual investors. And I had to get all 28 investors to the house and convince them all to take like 20 cents on the dollar. So those were fairly complex too. So
I've never done one of those myself.
Right. So I think I was very fortunate to start out in a really bad market. But that particular deal was so, so complicated.
You're dealing with, I mean, I've gone through this. Have I ever sold a house for a billionaire? I don't think so. But I've sold a house for multimillionaires. And one can't help but think very, very rich people have very, very well paid attorneys. So we have to watch every little micro step that we take, as we do for anyone,
yes.
But stakes are even higher for...
The difference in this particular case is there was actually a complicated transaction. It wasn't just a straight sale. If there was a house that was $100 million, brand new construction, people definitely have attorneys and accountants and everyone scrutinizing it a lot closer. You're going to have inspections that are going to be more intense. But in that case, it isn't that different.
Right.
Especially if it's a market where there are homes selling for that price. So it's not that different in that case. But yeah. Often these people have special desires and needs and quirks, and it's very, very high touch. So I'd say one of the big differences is how high touch it is. I know agents, I coach for Tom Ferry, so I know agents all over the country and all over price ranges. And the guy that's selling 100 or 200 houses a year, you know, in other areas, and the average price is 250, they actually have their own set of complexities that us guys in Beverly Hills couldn't pull off at all. In many ways, those people are more sophisticated than us because they're running these operations where they're having hundreds and hundreds of transactions. There's really no room for any error. The systems have to be absolutely rock solid. And that just takes a different sense of skills that I personally don't have, actually. I just don't have those skills. What we have here in Beverly Hills on the high end is our ability to deal with people.
Yeah.
And all these nuances and very high touch and very, very accommodating.
Yeah, it's the true white glove experience, isn't it? I mean, it's a lot different. And it's interesting because, you know, I personally and my company, we do all price ranges. And sometimes that super high touch doesn't work for some people. They're like, hey, stop bothering me. I can research this on my own. I'm just going to come back to you with a few questions, but I'm all good. Whereas the kind of the higher up you go, the more I think they expect us, quite rightly, to spell everything out. Spell it out in person, walk people through documents. It's interesting the nuances between the categories.
Another thing that a good point you make, I don't approach every person the same. It's not like I've got this exact formula. There's room because there's all kinds of different people and different situations. And, you know, when you're selling $250,000 homes and you have to sell 100 or 200 of them to make a lot of money, you approach almost everyone exactly the same. You don't have the luxury of, you know, custom accommodating each person. And if you miss a deal or someone doesn't fit within your framework and you don't do that deal or you give it back, so be it. In that case, they've got to accommodate you.
Agreed. Now, there are guys out there thinking, how the hell do you find $100 million listings? $100 million listing is a whale, right? I don't think you do those every day of the week, but you do a lot of 5, 10, 15, 20. So how do you find clients that are in that upper echelon that not only have properties that are worth that much, but then trust you to with the sale? How have you earned their business over the years?
That's a really good question. And I'm gonna give you that, like how that one came about. In 2009, I had just come off of working on developments for several years. I went all in on developments and got my little butt kicked because I had billions of dollars literally worth of listings. If the market would have stayed solid, I would have made a gazillion dollars, but it all fell apart.
Right.
And I literally ignored my resale business for the most part and was virtually unknown. I mean, if you stop doing this job for a few months, they forget about you.
Sure.
Yeah. So it's not like you can just go away. So I remember I couldn't get I went on a listing appointment for $3 million when I had to make a comeback. And I couldn't get the $3 million listing. He said, show me why I would give it to you. Cause I came off my, how successful it is. And I couldn't demonstrate it in the recent future to him. But what happened is, I ended up in, when I was doing resale, when I was doing developments, I started using Zillow. I didn't believe in Zillow. This is really early on. I just didn't think it had anything to do with Beverly Hills. advertising there, but I had a budget that I needed to spend. And I thought it was prudent with this development to invest in digital. It was this new form. And back then, you know, the zip codes that you buy now that's on the right, that is their main business now. Back then, their main business was the banner ad in the right corner. And they would throw in the one on the right, which is now their main business, for free. So I was buying the right corner for this development. And just because I was the agent on it, they were giving me the right one for free.
Oh, wow.
So I was literally the only person in Beverly Hills that was using Zillow. And I killed it. And I did really well with Zillow. I also became really good friends with the guys at Zillow. They asked me to sell a house for charity back then. And I did. And it was for Ashton Kutcher's house. I sold his house for charity and, you know, gave away most of my commission. And I ended up meeting an architect there. So this architect, you probably know, William Hefner.
Yep.
William Hefner, his wife was doing a living room, and I liked him, and I ended up giving him a client, because I just sold a house. I gave him a client, and he did a $1 million job for a client of mine. And I said to him, if you ever have clients that question whether they're building the right house or they're overpaying or what they think of a neighborhood or any real estate questions, I'm not looking to sell these people. These are your clients. But if they ever need a question, I'm here to be of service. So a couple of years later, he said, I've got a guy that thinks he's overbuilding. Will you go give me your opinion? So I went over there and I ended up running into the client, and I told him he wasn't overbuilding, but he ended up wanting to maybe try to sell it anyways. He ended up becoming a client of mine. And 2 years later, he happened to be the guy that controlled the Playboy Mansion.
Oh, wow. Isn't that funny?
So hold on, 2 years later, but I wasn't there. There are other guys in this business that really were the obvious choices, even though I was highly competent. But I got a seat at the table, and I was able to go and make a presentation. And actually did at the presentation, he called me and said that we've all decided to go with another agent. They think they're better. And I ended up getting it. And by just showing up, and this is probably my biggest, kind of secret, is I act as people's agents before they give me the job. I provide value before I get anything, and I give it out there for free. And I'm happy to help anybody. And as a result of that, when you become invaluable, you're going to get business from that. And it feels really organic, and it feels really good to me. But I did get the Playboy Mansion because I was a mensch, and someone trusted me, and I demonstrated who I was without any obligation. And I took it. Listen, at one point I remember thinking, I have a shot at this. And I had to wrap my head around me listing that property. And then at one point I said, I'm going to get this. I went from, I have a shot at this. I go, I am getting this listing. And even when they said you lost, I didn't hear it. Yeah. I turned around and I said, give me 10 minutes. I want to send you some facts. And they ended up giving it to me because I just all of a sudden had that mindset that I'm getting this listing. And then we had this crazy way we had to sell it. We had to sell it where Hef got to stay there for the rest of his life, which is a little hard to say.
Didn't realize that was the case.
Buy the most expensive home in the history of Los Angeles. Oh, and by the way, the owner gets to stay there till he dies.
Oh, wow.
And I just got, and then I got in the mindset that I can do that as well. So I really did get this, and I don't have that 24/7 on everything. But I did get on those cases, I got in the mindset, A, I can get this, and then B, I'm getting this. And I had such focus, it was crazy to get that deal done. I mean, I literally was completely unwavering. And there was plenty of noise and drama, and I just didn't hear anything other than I just had my eye on the finish line.
Well, I like that you framed all of this, there are three keywords that have been a large part of my life for the past nearly 20 years, which is be of service, right? And that has been my mantra. When I was a brand new agent, I didn't care. There was a pal of mine that said, Pete, his name's Brian Moore, and he said, Pete, just get him in the car and show him what you know. And that really registered with me. And then that kind of paralleled into be of service. And I teach this to my guys at PLG. I say, don't look for what you can get out of the relationship immediately. Look at what you can contribute to then earn trust. Because once you've earned trust, you then earn business. But I would say the most agents, and most agents I come across are good folks. But it's rare when I see someone launch into a relationship with hopes but not expectations, and I've always found that's where the gold lies. If I remove expectations and remain in service, the business seems to take care of itself.
It certainly can. And I've heard people go, well, what if someone like screws you over? And I go, so what?
Yeah,
it happened once. It'll happen once. There's such an abundance of business out there right now.
Yeah.
There's so much business available. The rub is that there's business for everybody. So we're all chasing after the same people.
Yeah. But there's enough. There's always enough cake to go around. There always is. It's not up to you and I who, you and I turn up each day. We work as hard as we can, but then what deals we get and don't get really is up to Mother Universe.
Right.
I think. Maybe you're more in tune with Mother Universe than I am.
No, I'm completely in agreement. In fact, there was a client I had that was like my client, and I lost touch with him for 6 months, and you sold him a property.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Touche.
I wonder who that was. It wasn't a $100 million property, though.
No, but they could afford it.
Ah!
The parents could.
I need to think who that was. How many years ago was it?
It was probably the last couple of years. The wife was ridiculously good looking.
I have to go back through my memory banks. Wow, that's interesting. You caught me off guard there. So, right. Gary, you mentioned something else as well about giving it away, right? I'm a very big believer in giving away. Knowledge is not owned, it's borrowed.
And by the way, I don't do that because I'm some saint or some good guy. I just think it's a best practice. I am a good guy, but that is not the reason I'm doing it. It is the best practice. You could be a complete schmuck and you should still do that.
Agreed. So let's talk about your video series, 30 Years of Experience, which I imagine, and I don't wish to be rude, you're probably going to be labeling 40 Years of Experience soon, right?
I'm 58, but I started when I was 17. So
41 years.
Be ridiculous. You know, to be in business 41 years, you used to have to be dead.
Some of them still are in the valley. Anyway, so let's talk about your video series, 30 Years of Experience. So you have this, for those guys out there, I'll post a link in the podcast so you can see Gary's videos, and I'll post you links to everything, Gary, as well. Tell us about, how did that come about? What results have you got from it? Why do you do it? Let's talk about that.
The first reason I'm a good communicator and I'm a good teacher. And I have found when I teach people things, I learn on a deeper level. Again, I'm not necessarily doing it because I'm some philanthropist. I do get more out of teaching people than the people who I'm teaching. Not that the people I'm teaching don't get a lot out of it, but I get a lot out of it. One of the benefits I never saw coming is I'm getting listings from it, which really blows me away. I didn't think that it was going to be a moneymaker, and it's turned out to be, on top of that, a moneymaker. That I'm getting co-listings from other brokers because of, which is wonderful. I mean, I can't tell you how many people are saying, listen, I was gonna call Peter Lorimer, but I just watched your video series, and I gotta call you, man.
Oi, touche.
He's got the phony British accent. So it's taken on a life of its own, and I'm doing public speaking now with it, and I really like it, but I really do like imparting what I know with other people. And it does help me learn it on a deeper level. I mean, I assume that probably resonates with you as well.
It does. And you know, it's interesting, when I was kind of coming up through the ranks, I was a former record producer. So I was the guy always kind of elbows deep in the tech and in the direction and imparting, I guess, musical wisdom to people to create a good product. And the niche I found in real estate was, as much as I enjoyed being an agent, I really love being a mentor. And that's one of the driving forces of why I started PLG, because I really do get an immense amount of satisfaction out of watching these new agents. They're not all new, some are from other companies. And I see them come in, sometimes they're scared and freaked out and their careers are not as good as they could be. And I sit with them and I work with them for a year or two, and then they blossom into these, not just great agents, but awesome people. And that's where I get my, that's the biggest kick for me.
Right. I mean, I did want to be a stand-up comedian. I did want to be a writer.
There's still time.
Well, you know what? Every time I'm on TV or every time I do a video series or every time I do a talk, it's just a delivery system for me to do shtick. I mean, that's it, really. I mean, it is, and my humor is all based on the truth. So when I go and do a talk, it's funny, and I get to do that thing. And you know what? When you do public speaking, you want to know that your audience is reacting to you.
Sure. And
what better way than if they're laughing?
Yeah.
And in a conference, people are usually laughing because it's like, it's resonating. It's true. I mean, you can only do so much shtick. It really has to have some truth behind it. And that's my comedy is based on the truth behind it. So it really is solving a lot of things for me. And I love the performance part of it as well. I like to perform. In fact, I still don't completely know what it is, but I can feel that doing this makes sense. It's leading me towards a bigger thing. I kind of could see where it could head, but I've already been surprised that it's had value where I didn't even realize it would have value.
And it's interesting. I had a mate of mine, Jesse Peters, who I don't know if you know him, but he's a big video guy from Canada. He's actually one of the guys at Inman 2015 who pushed me into doing my first video, and I've never really looked back. I sat down with him in my office in Beverly Hills, and we started going through how many people are actually in our, there's approximately 2.5 million real estate agents between Canada and the US, right? Out of that 2.5 million people on a regular basis, people doing original content on a dependable amount, like a series, is probably less than 25.
Wow.
Which I found staggering. I'm not including home videos and home tours and drone shoots. I'm talking about original content like you and I do. I certainly doubt there's less than 50. So,
you know, another interesting fact is of the 2.5 million real estate agents, 2 million of them work in Beverly Hills.
No kidding. all right. Well, listen, I know you are. I have two other things that I think you've kind of covered it, because I was going to go over what are your top three tips to become a successful agent. I mean, I think you've already covered it, but if you could hit them, if you anything springs to mind, just hit me.
Well, I think where all the money is in real estate is converting leads, not getting leads. Getting leads is easy. You know, sometimes people don't recognize what leads are, but getting leads is easy. It's converting leads, and we're all after, you know, for every lead you have, 10 other agents have the same lead. So going from that 1 in 10 to being the one is where all the money is.
You need to say that again, because for anybody listening to that, that is so important. For every lead that you think you have, 10 other agents also probably have the same lead.
Now, sometimes it's 3 and sometimes it's 20, but it is a lot. You're not the only real estate agent they know. And especially today, a lot of the basic things they don't need us for. So the one thing you need to do is that you need to have a fairly good system to know who your clients are and constantly be touching them and calling them. And I call it pushing buttons, calling them for relevant reasons. Don't call people up. I guess there's someone who's so charming they could do this. I'm not that person.
That might be me.
Calling people up and saying, hey, I'm just checking in. I hate that. I always call people and say, hey, like, let's just say there's a seller who's thinking of selling. And you know, in luxury, our gestation period of someone thinking of selling and selling could be 2 or 3 years.
Yeah.
It could be different in a different market. But when the first inception, it could be a long process. And so I'm always like, hey, the house next door to you just went on the market. I wanted to let you know the one across the street sold. And an interesting thing, if you tell a seller the house across the street just sold and you give them the information, they're going to associate you with that. If they call you and say, did you hear the house across the street sold? They're going to think you're a chump. So you want to be the provider of information. You want to tell them about interest rates. You want to tell them about whatever it is. I keep on touching people with text, email, calling, and saying things and providing value and getting a conversation going. And at some point, it's really interesting. All of a sudden, you're not getting anywhere with them. And then all of a sudden you say the right thing and they go, okay, let's put it on the market.
So you just keep you keep touching them with information that's pertinent to them as a homeowner or a family or what have you.
Yes. Now in luxury, I'm pretty high touch. I'm not like just sending them an email every time I farted. That's not my jam. even though I do a little bit, if I have something interesting to post on Facebook and they're my friends, I do get listings that way by, you know, doing that. But I get more by actually picking up the phone and calling them about something relevant. People are really interested in real estate.
Yeah.
It's not that hard. If you call somebody who's owns, he just owns a house, and you tell them that about a sale in their neighborhood that might, and you can, you know, connect it to their home in some way that they can kind of, you know, quantify that. That's interesting.
Now, there are guys here that are not selling luxury, but I remember back in the day when I started, which was back in 2004, it was all phone calls, and then phone calls became annoying. Then it went to emails and then texts. But now I feel there is so much digital noise. Breaking through that digital noise is a skill set in itself.
Yes, I'll give you this is another good point. Not only do people have preferences of text, email, phone calls, they also have patterns. My best client, who I finally landed, who's been more business to me than anything, initially I met him in person, and then I kept on calling him, and I got nowhere for weeks. He just didn't return my call.
Right.
And then I decided to send him an email, nothing. And then I texted him, and every time I'm changing my whatever what I'm saying a little bit, I texted him nothing. Then I texted him in a slightly different way at a slightly different time, and bam, he said, let's go take a look at that. And I was, next thing we were off to the races, and then he no longer wanted to text. He only wanted to talk on the phone. And then the second we actually got involved in a transaction, he only wanted voicemail. So people have patterns as well. And if you are trying to reach someone, if, let's say you're super diligent and you got your act together and you're coached and you're listening to Peter Lorimer and every morning at 9 o'clock, you're calling this guy like crazy and it's not working, why don't you call him at 5 p.m.?
Mm-hmm.
Why don't you send him an email? Why don't you text him? Why don't you not say the same shit you've been saying to him over and over? Why don't you change something up? Because you don't know what's going to resonate with him. Because you said there, how you pierce through the noise is you say something that has impact. You actually say something that doesn't sound like noise. And a lot of it also has to do with timing.
Agreed.
But you got to take a lot of at-bats. So that's what I do. And that's if you can learn that dance, that's huge.
Do you still reach out to people who have given you no response after maybe even a couple of years?
I have a listing right now, and I sold a house recently to a big celebrity, and I have a listing now to a big celebrity. Both of them, I've been pursuing to get his listing for 3 years, and the other one for 5 years. And the 5 years one did not respond to me for 5 years. And I finally said something where he goes, 5 years. Now, keep in mind, 5 years, every time his house expired or something happened, I would contact him, got nothing. And then I finally said, I have this other listing in Malibu. Malibu's hotter than shit or whatever I said. And I said, your home should sell. We should talk. Your photography is not what it should be. And he just emailed me back, we should talk. And finally, I said the right thing. He goes, we should talk.
It's amazing.
I hate when people go, I'm just checking in. I'm just checking in. Basically, what you're saying on a cellular level is, I have nothing to offer you, but if you're about to buy or sell your property, I want to make a commission. So I'm just checking in.
I really like that. That's really powerful, because I know over the years I've written many checking in emails, but I always put in there, you know, it, like for example, 2018, the market's really powerful. It's frothy right now. If you're thinking about selling, I put some item in there. I don't just do a, you know, checking in, hope you're good. If you want anything, I'm here. No.
Now, you might, by not doing what I do, you might reach three times more people or call three times more people. Mine takes time. I don't pick up the phone without something to say. I pick up the phone or make an email or send a text with something to say. But my success rate on, if I talk to 8 people, I'm going to do a deal with one of them.
Powerful.
Most people, they have to talk to 80. So, and it feels better to me. Yeah. I'm actually the most insecure guy in the world if I have nothing to say. I only have the balls to call somebody if I actually am bringing something to the table. If I don't, I actually am pretty insecure about it.
That's really powerful, Gary. And I think you've said a lot of great stuff today, but that little nugget there to any agents who are beginning a career, again, it goes back to being of service, right? How can we be of service to the relationship by giving something of value without expecting? We hope, but we don't expect.
And you know, it's funny, you can feel it when you're starting to get in this groove and giving someone some information. It feels really good. But if you're really, if you're having a tough time making calls to leads, it's probably because you've got nothing to offer them.
Yeah. It's very interesting because I just this morning, I had one of my celebrity music clients, right, who called me a couple of weeks ago. He's got an investment property. And he said, you know, I think I want to sell it. And he told me what he was paying on it a month. And I'm like, you should refi that sucker and keep it because it's a beautiful mid-century home. And I'm like, you should just keep it, dude. Don't sell it. And I said, if you're not getting the results from your people, talk to my people about a loan. And he said, you were right. I can refi it and I can bring all the payments down. But you know what? I still want to sell it. Put it on the market.
Right. Right.
And
exactly.
That to me was gold. Pardon the pun.
A similar thing. I remember I sold a home and before it hit the market, we showed it to one person and they wrote us a full price offer. It's a kind of a similar thing. Just, I also have a saying that the truth is the best bullshit. So we got a full price offer and my developer client who just spent 2 years building this house said, I wonder if we underpriced it. Instead of getting defensive on him, because I really don't know, I said, it is very possible we did and you left $50,000 or $100,000 on the table. I said, it's also possible that we hit it on the number and we have it well priced. And this person really wants it and they're paying you a premium. So I think the real thing is the question is, do you want to risk possibly selling it for 50 or 100 less and have it take several months or get 100 more? That's the question. Yeah. It's all possible. It's a risk reward thing. Is it worth to you to roll the dice or would you like to get this score now at full price? And by saying that, it completely diffused it. He was able to look at what was best for him. Yeah. And I was just giving him honest information. And you know what? The truth is, I didn't know. And I'm capable of being the salesman and say, you've got to take this deal. But I think it's not my jam. It's not my style.
Not mine either. Okay, two last questions, because I'm sure you got a jam. Okay. If you weren't doing real estate, what would you do? And what was your wackiest sale?
Okay. Well, if I wasn't doing real estate, what I'd like to do, I don't know what I do. I don't know what I'm capable of, but I would love to be a writer.
Okay.
I am a writer. I don't know if it's a comedian or a screenwriter, but I am a good writer and I loved writing. And I actually would love right now being a public speaker more than probably anything. I totally love that.
Yeah.
My wackiest deal. The Playboy Mansion, having a house.
So right.
Hugh Hefner has to stay there for the rest of his life. It's hard. That's hard to beat.
That's hard to beat. Playboy Mansion, $100 million plus, only house in LA at that price, with a guy that's known by everyone on the planet, who, by the way, wants to stay there till he dies. I don't think it gets wackier than that, mate.
Exactly.
All right, Gary Gold, thank you very, very much. You have been an amazing, amazing guest on the podcast. You should follow Gary. I'm going to send all of his links and put all of his stuff here. Right. He is not just a god of real estate. He's a really good guy. And yeah, I'm sure some of the people might reach out to you, but I want to thank you personally for taking the time, Gary. You're a love.
It was awesome. You were great. Thanks.
That's it for another podcast for this week. I want to thank everybody for tuning in. I really, really appreciate all the comments that I've been getting. You guys have been pinging me offline, online, by carrier pigeon, whatever method you can find. I will have another podcast for you here again next week. Don't forget to share it with all your mates. And of course, you've got to subscribe. Thanks for listening.